Hello, dear students, you are welcome to the UGC lecture series on educational psychology. And today, I have chosen a subject of very important interest to all of us, and the subject is personality. Once we look into the literature on personality in psychology or education, sometimes we find that there is a shocking experience so far as the definition or the nature of the concept is concerned. That's why I have chosen, or rather selected, to talk on the concept so that things become clearer before we go into the theoretical details later on. Now, first of all, if we look at the concept itself and see its popular usage, popularly, how do people react to a concept like personality? If you ask anyone, what do you understand by personality? He would say, personality is rather a person's beauty, a person how impressive he is. You see, once we say that a person possesses personality, we see if there is a long fellow, a tall fellow, and a very beautiful physique person, and you will say he has lots of personality. He is wonderful. If he can talk well, if he can have some impression upon you, based on that impression, you would say that he can be given a very good mark on his personality. Experts in psychology, they tried very hard to find out how they can reach the concept of personality for defining purposes alone. One amongst them is Professor Alport. He has actually surveyed more than 30,000 definitions on personality. And while categorizing those definitions, has come to a kind of decision that all such definitions can be categorized in three different types. Number one, those definitions, those concepts which take personality as an external matter. That is, one, as you look at the physique of a person, you have an idea about his personality. Once you look at his communicability, at his communication power, you have a kind of look. Once you look how he treats and impresses people, you have an idea. But all such ideas put together make a category which Alport calls as external effect definition. That is, personality can be looked into by looking at the physique of the person, at the ways he behaves as a matter of fact, and the ways as he communicates, talks with people as such. That is the kind of impressionistic concept. How do we impress others? Impressions built up on people, and those people, on the basis of those impressions, would suggest that a personality is being possessed by a person, or it is not being possessed. Now, once we go through this definition, perhaps you would tend not to agree, only because this is a kind of a cosmetic treatment. If you see, all those people have personality who are tall enough, then what will happen to those people who are short enough? Do they not possess any personality? If you think that all handsome people in the world have personality, what will happen to those people who otherwise you think to be ridiculous, or who are ugly, or who don't possess beauty? If we think only those people whose, you know, behaviors are public, like leaders, whether they are political leaders, they are academic leaders, they are teachers, they are doctors, etc., only they have personality, then what about those people who are not known to public? So in this way, it seems as if the definition goes to have an ornamental concept of personality as such. And second, that how do people impress others? I can have one person and I have hundreds of impressions about the person as such. And how do, in turn, I impress upon you? In the morning, one impression I can give. During the day, another impression I can give. And in the evening, some other impression. So if you collect all these impressions, would you reach anywhere? This impressionistic kind of approach to understanding a personality would definitely fail. It may give you some idea about his whereabouts, his mannerism, his behavior, whatever, but it would not give you understanding of the concept of personality as such. So this is one way. The second category of definitions takes into consideration what Alport calls a kind of positivist stand. That is, if personality is not what it seems to be, then why don't you discover it? Why don't you find it? And finding personality means using of some instruments, tests, strategies, some assessment techniques. Yes. So if you have a testing measure, testing rod, assessment technique, put it, administer it on people and see the scores and then find what type of personality a person possesses or what personality is. So in this way, personality can be defined in terms of the test scores. So for instance, if you have 16 PF, that is 16 personality factor test, which has been devised by Cattell. And if you place that test or administer this on people, it will give you information on 16 different factors which are being possessed or not being possessed by the person concerned. So once you have that, you have actually a profile. Means, like, for I make it very easy for you, is for instance, it gives you a score on whether you are very affectionate or you are cold, whether you hate people or you love people, whether you are very intelligent or you are less intelligent, whether you are always anxious or you are relaxed. So these are the ways in which a profile of a person can be understood through the tests. If you have tested things, perhaps today's world, we test even major, minor diseases, illnesses, or even eyesight, any physical trait can be tested. Likewise, if you can test personality through psychological tests and instruments, perhaps we can understand what personality is. But the point is that on the basis of tests, would it be possible for us to go beyond those 16 factors or 3 factors? If you take another, you know, instance of, say, Professor Eisenick, he gives information on 3 different profiles, whether a person is extrovert, introvert, or neurotic. So any dimensions on any test skills would give you knowledge or information on those dimensions alone. But what about a person who has some very important dimension which is not exhibited, which is not available on that testing measure or scale, but that is hallmark of his personality? And there the information will be lacking. Therefore, once you have this objective understanding or objective testing of persons, you will not have all such characteristics or traits of a particular person in question assessed, which he has. You have the information only on those dimensions and factors which are being available or are being made available to people on a testing scale. There can be a use or advantage of this kind of thing. That is, if you want different people for different types of jobs, you can find a psychological use or a, say, counseling use, that you need highly intelligent people for a particular kind of vocation, job, or occupation. Perhaps this test would help. It would give you a psychograph of the person. You can just make a decision. Or for counseling purposes also, if you feel that this test would help, that there are some people who are more anxious, they are more anxiety ridden, maybe more stressful situation as such, for such people you may devise a technique for treatment. But largely talking, this is not an obvious solution to the problem of what personality actually is. Rather, personality would skip out of your imagination once you start focusing on traits alone. And more so, the traits which have been demonstrated are available because of the measurement of, administration of certain testing skills. Then the third category is labeled as internal structure definitions. This is one where we have to consider, or we have to rest a little longer. Here, those definitions have been put together, which talk of internal dynamism. That is, a personality is something which is evolving dynamically. And this is a result of interaction of a number of factors put together. And in philosophy, earlier they would talk that personality is essentially there. It is something which is essentially there, for which certain moments you find physical expression, on certain other occasions you don't find their expression, but they are being possessed. But what is most important about these internal structure definitions is that not only physical things which are available to our naked eye are can be potentially made available, but what is more important is that certain structures which otherwise are not accessible to research, you cannot lay down your hand upon. Internal structural definition would tell us that yes, there is a possibility of such factors and their existence. Now, this dynamism has been focused by Professor Alpert throughout his works on personality. He is one of the most important sources, experts on personality psychology as such. He would say that what happens under this structural consistency? Number one, that a personality, if you take in terms of traits, those traits should be interacting, which actually they interact. And that interaction should be with consistency, at least over a period of time. And if that consistency and that stability is there, that gives you a kind of concept, that gives you a kind of product which you may really call personality. For instance, this can be made very clear by looking into the definition given by Alpert himself. That is, personality is a dynamic organization within the individual of those psychophysical systems or traits that determine his unique behavior and thought. Now, if you look at various structures or systems used within the definition itself, that would clearly give us an idea of internal structure arrangement, where we find that primarily, what's personality? Primarily, fundamentally, basically, essentially, personality is an dynamic organization. So, once we talk of dynamic, means it is changing, ever-changing structure. Organization working under certain principles of those psychophysical systems. We are talking, you see, please take care of the words being used. Psychophysical systems, that there are psychological systems, there are physical systems. And these psychological and physical systems are working, interacting in such a manner that they determine the characteristic thought and behavior of the individual. So you have a characteristic thought and behavior. Characteristic means one style of thinking, one style of behavior. Individual's behavior becomes predictable. You can predict your friend's behavior. You can predict your teacher's behavior. How is that possible? How can you predict your parents' behavior, your teacher's behavior, your student's behavior, your friend's behavior, or even your, you know, shopkeeper's behavior? It is only possible because that particular person whose behavior you can predict in a particular situation, because that person is known to you by the way, the style he is adopting. And that the style that he is adopting is not a matter of simple occasion, are a kind of stress situation. It is consistently prolonging with him for a number of years together. That's why I can predict. Now, this definition, therefore, is very comprehensive one, in which your physical features have been taken care of, for which you would otherwise feel perhaps sorry because external effect definition, then you would totally avoid or ignore. But here he takes care of your physical features, that is physical characteristics as a person. Second, it takes care of psychological characteristics also, which are not available in first, that is external effect, or positive strand, that is scientific assessment of personality, it's not available there. Therefore, psychological traits are also being taken care. But what more is taken care of is their interaction. It's very important. If you look and if you see some of the books in psychology or even education, you will find that the generally textbook writers would define personality as personality is a sum total of all physios, psycho and social characteristics of a person. Sum, note sum, which is wrong. Personality is not sum total. Once I take into consideration, and you would also take this, the treatment made by Alport, it is not sum, it is rather interaction. It is not summative, it is interactive or multiplicative. So that you find what you do is, you have trait one and you have trait two. You cannot add, for instance, you can't say that personality is T1 plus T2 plus T3 plus Tn. You can't say. And that is not true also. But the alternative would be T1 into multiply by T2 multiply by T3 multiply by Tn. You can go to infinite limits. And once you put them in a multiplicative form, what you are actually trying to do is that you are showing that traits are interacting permanently within the structure of the individual. And once they interact, new traits or their combinations are formulated. And that is what is personality. That's why personality springs up dynamically. And you find that people who have that kind of personality is the multiplication of number of traits working. And at certain occasions, traits colored by situations or environment as such, and on other occasions, completely, totally reflecting, representing the internal thinking of the person. The second point that I would like that you should consider, I'm talking on the characteristic thought and behavior. Characteristic that gives you uniqueness in ideation, uniqueness in thinking, that each individual is uniquely made. So how do I think would be different from how you think. So if you have 3, 4, 5, 10 persons sitting together, you have 10 different perceptions of one single situation. And if you find that this is there, that is, these 10 different people are differently made. So the principle or the law of individual differences is paramount. And if you would like to understand this law, understand how people differ from each other, you shall have to turn back to the internal structure arrangement or definition of the concept of personality. When I say, therefore, characteristic thought and behavior. Characteristic is unique behavior that I adopt in all the situations I am working. Characteristic thought, the way in which I think in all situations, makes those things my things, those traits my traits, those ideas my ideas, and collectively that behavior my behavior. Now please try to look from educational point of view. Or in other words, if you like to seek the educational implications of this, kind of definition, I say that you will be in a very comfortable situation and you will find that this is profitable. That is, in education, we are really related not with the collective kind of things, but individual components and individual contributions made by students as such. If I say that unique and characteristic thought of a particular person, take it as an individual student as such. How would he learn? Would he be a fast learner, a slow learner, an average learner? Would depend upon how his personality is made. That is personality makeup. I would not hesitate telling you that learning in this way would become a function of one's personality. We have talked much about learning, and you will read more about learning as such. But today you get an idea that learning is not because the phenomena which can be connected exclusively with environmental condition, with a school situation, with a textbook situation, with your syllabus as a matter of fact, with the teacher's personality as such, but learning is a personality factor. More precisely, giving you an example, if your personality is dominant by anxiety pattern, that is, it is anxiety-prone personality, learning will not enter into your mind. You will not learn. Whose mind is full of anxiety, there is no scope for learning. And once we talk of dynamism in personality as such, for a classroom teacher, he has to provide situations to children in which this dynamic orientation, which is already existing within the structure of the personality, becomes more effective, more impressive, more profitable. I hope by now certain things have been made clear. But at this point, I would also make a small summary of criticisms made against these types. One, external effect is not acceptable because it is impressionistic, it is a cosmetic arrangement, it leaves out all such people who otherwise have a lot of personality, but because they are not public, because they don't have good physique, because they can't impress people very immediately, therefore perhaps they don't possess. But on the contrary, they are the people who are sitting in the ethics of obscurity, but are having wonderful personalities. Second is positivist, where I have emphasized it, that some points can be missed, which are otherwise cardinal or hallmark of one's personality, but are not available on testing measures. And third is internal, which is acceptable only because which takes care is a very comprehensive kind of thing, which takes into care your physical, external, either positive stand or even takes care of our internal organization also. There are ways to understand the concept of personality in a better way. And one such way is to follow an expert. And expert that I suggest is Alport. And his views I have actually discussed. Now I would like to make a brief summary of the views pointed out by him. Number one, he says, once we look on the personality, we have three ways to understand personality. One is external effect way, his physique, his impressions he makes, and three, his behavior which is available to us. Second is a positivist stand, which means taking the help or the support of the tests which are available in personality psychology. And because of the tests and test scores, we try to understand what personality is. And third, the last or the final way is internal structure definitions, which stress the internal dynamism connected with individuality or uniqueness of a person. Now later, we'll be talking on different approaches to the understanding of personality. Means there is a type approach, there's a trait approach to understand, there's a factor approach to understand personality, maybe in our coming lectures. We'll be talking on approaches. Thank you.